Hi, welcome to the Talyllyn Railway. I'm Frank Nolan. I'm a trustee in the Narrow Gauge Railway Museum. I work on the trains as a volunteer, and I also work for the Talyllyn Railway Company. And as Stuart seeks out pastures new, you'll be seeing me and other new faces presenting these videos. And I'd like to present a face with which I'm sure you're familiar already. This is Ian Drummond from the Talyllyn's Heritage Group.
Hi, Frank. Nice to see you. Hello, everybody. Nice to see you as well. Well, about a year ago, Stuart and I took a wander at the extension from Abergwyn-Olwyn, and we did a little video which had a big reveal. And the big reveal, if folk remember, was the slate columns for the reconstruction of the Ty Dwr watering point. So what we thought would be good this time round would be to come back a year on and see what's happened since, because you'll see there's quite a bit that has happened. Last time we were here, there were just the slate columns in place, but now we actually have all the trough system, the wooden troughs that convey the water from the waterfall over there down to the line side, ready to go into the loco.
And I notice it's weathering in and bedding in nicely now. It's starting to look like it's always been here.
Well, that's right. It is amazing, isn't it, what the Welsh weather will do. Just put something out in the Welsh weather, it weathers like nobody's business. I mean, you know, we've got, this is the wooden trough, or one of the wooden troughs that actually you use to actually water the loco, because obviously the water coming to here isn't terribly useful as such. But if, by means of putting this trough and hooking it on the shelf up there and then over across on top of the loco, we can get the water right into the locomotive itself. But you can see how already just being out in the Welsh weather has changed the colour of that quite significantly.
Well, when was it first in this location? Because I know this is actually a rebuild of a pre-existing facility.
Well, most of this was built for the opening of the railway in 1865. So up to this point, this is, if you like, the reconstruction of the original part, because just beyond us on this side, on the other side there, is where the original loco shed was. And there was a siding here that ran along through here up to the loco shed. But that only lasted in general use until the sheds in Pendray came in 1867. And then locomotive shed was down there, workshop down there, etc. But the siding and the shed remained here for about another 30 years until about the 1890s, something like that, and it was taken out. And at that point, they extended the trough over and built this tower here, which you can see is slightly, shall we say,
I was going to ask you about that. This is slightly less articulate looking, though you mentioned earlier this is deliberate.
Yeah, it is. I mean, the original one of this was less well constructed, shall we say. It wasn't constructed by the skilled craftsmen that had done these columns, and so our contractors have well reproduced this in sort of reality.
And a fine job they've done, because it actually reproduces that inarticulacy that I mentioned. Yeah. Very accurately, and it actually makes a nice feature.
Yeah, that's it. Other changes we've had to do, we have to say up here, is one of the issues was how we can get the water flowing safely down the trough when we want it and not flowing when it does, because we're only going to be using this watering point for special trains and on odd occasions. So we don't want the water flowing all the time, because it's just going to wash away the ballast, rot the sleepers and everything else. So, and the other problem is we had no photographs of this end of the whole apparatus. So Mike Christensen, who is the designer of all this, came up with this design, which is a flat, very simple type of flat valve, which just controls the flow of water. At the moment, you can see the water is being bypassed away from the trough. But if I can just get in here, just move that, close the flap there, and you can see now most of the water is now flowing down the trough. It takes a little while to get to the other end, and it flows then from the waterfall all the way down, and then it flows down back to the other end, and hopefully it should be coming out there in just a few moments. So here you are, you can see the water flowing out the other end, and if we had a locomotive here, it would be all ready to start filling the water tank.
Excellent. Well, as you can see, it's been a fantastic success, and we'd like to extend our gratitude to all the members and supporters who've contributed to making this particular project come to fruition, and of course the craftsmen whose skills have made this possible. So, what's next on the Heritage Trail?
Well, let's go and have a look.
Now, of all the heritage features on the Talyllyn, I find this one of the most captivating. I don't know if we were unique in having this, but I don't think there are many inclines built for the purpose of taking traffic off a railway. Most of the inclines of which I'm aware were used within slate quarries and the like for moving product within those industrial areas. This particular incline was built purely to connect with Abergynolwyn village, as you can see further down below. The rails were lifted very early on in the lifetime of the Preservation Society. Because they hadn't seen locomotive usage, they were actually in very good condition and they were used elsewhere on the railway. And of course, we can judge the actions of our predecessors harshly if we wish, but of course they had to make decisions based on criteria that prevailed at the time. What we have got left are these remnants of the rails that went to the edge of the incline. And the site of the winding house, which powered the incline, was about here. And I'm sure Ian can fill us in now on the backstory on the incline house itself.
Yeah, I mean, it's getting quite interesting what we're sort of finding out up here. As you can see, there was, in one sense, very little remaining of the actual winding house itself. And originally, the main line ran on roughly where the line of rails is now, on the Wackham turntable. The Wackham turntable wasn't on this side at this point, but it actually ran through the winding house itself. So this, of course, wasn't for passenger trains, this part of the line. This was purely for loaded slate wagons, empty slate wagons going back and forth from Binaglewis at the top end. So they would, if they were going up the top or coming back down the top, they would just go straight through the middle of the winding house itself. There was another line that ran a little bit sort of further over than the current main line runs, round the back of the winding house, and that was where this turntable was. And that was over on that side, and when wagons were wanting to go down the incline, they were uncoupled, put on the wagon turntable, turned through 90 degrees, then came through a track across a crossing point here and down onto the rails over the top. Now, this site has been disturbed quite a bit in the sort of 1990s. They're not that old now. The young members group then were doing some work up here, and they sort of put back some of the rails roughly in the positions that they were then to give an idea of what the site was like. There are still some original features. You can see the wood, the slate blocks still in place there. You can see the bollard that was used that's still in place there. And what we have been doing recently is Mike has been up here digging out the foundations. And so what you see here and here are the foundations of the north side of the winding house.
Because we should explain, to be pragmatic, due to its somewhat decrepit condition, our forebears felt it necessary to demolish the winding house itself.
There was two sort of driving forces to it. One was it was pretty decrepit. It was in danger literally of falling down. So something had to be done in that regard. Secondly, there was the ambition then to extend the railway up from, or passenger services on the railway, up from Abergynolwyn to Nant Gwernol. And so therefore there was going to have to be a change here because you couldn't run the passenger.
You mentioned the winding house itself wasn't built with passenger operation in mind.
No, you just couldn't, there wasn't the clearance to run the passenger trains through. So the line was rebuilt. And as you can see, the formation now is much higher.
It's very different. Yeah. And I notice, of course, we have the remnants of the original winding drum, which was housed high up in the winding house and fed by metal cables the incline itself.
That's right. This was a gravity sort of winding house. So there wasn't motor.
Very green.
Yeah, very green in that sense. It was literally, you know, loaded wagons went down, empty wagons came up, and this was the winding drum that was used. And when it came out in the 1960s, it was pretty intact, but over the years, rot has taken its toll.
And does the Heritage Group have any plans afoot to restore the drum in any way?
Yeah, our initial thoughts are, I mean, many people have asked about the winding house, etc. For many of the reasons that we've just been talking about, we can't put it back as it originally was. So what is the best sort of next best thing that we can do with it? That's really the question we're grappling with at the moment. But certainly the first thing we want to do is to stop this drum deteriorating any further
deterioration.
Yeah, because there have been some breaks in the metalwork, and Mike has been putting in some bracing and bolting that in, so you just to hold it together at this moment in time. Yeah. And then what we're planning to do on the site of the original foundations on this side is to build two smaller slate columns at the moment, not full height, but at least so we can get this off the ground, so out the mud and muck and everything else, and actually retimber it. So when trains come past and passengers have a look,
it'll help to interpret the site.
Yeah, they at least can get a better idea of what it was then. And it gives us time to think about what we're going to do with this long term. Because, yeah, we would like really people to really appreciate what this site was like. As you said earlier, this quite possibly is a unique, certainly in the UK, provision where there was this incline serving the village. Mm. Because when you got down to the village, there was also a network of rails up the back of the houses, etc. So goods, etc., could be taken literally to people's back door.
Yeah, I suppose it must have been very much a lifeblood for the village itself, because it's my understanding that provisions were delivered, beer, timber, slates, I understand, for the creation of writing slates, which of course were in demand at that time. And waste products could be removed, and it was a two-way street, so very much a living, breathing lifeline for the village.
It was. I mean, you know, coal went down there, fresh fish from Grimsby, we know, went down there on a daily basis.
Timber
went down because there was a sawmill at the bottom of the incline there, so they would take down logs on the incline and they would cut them up, and then that could be some of the loaded materials that came back up.
Now, interestingly, I think the incline itself is still vested in the railway.
Yep.
Would there be any plans in the future to have perhaps a demonstration scenario of how the incline worked?
Well, you never know. Never say never is what I say in the preservation world. You know, money, resources is always the issue. But yes, you're quite right. We do actually, you know, we do own all of the original incline. I can't see, in all honesty, us rebuilding the whole thing in its original state.
No, it's such a pity. Wouldn't it be great were we able to run wagons back there on behind the backs of houses?
There's a few health and safety issues to go with that, I think.
Not least the condition of this cable, I think.
Well, that's right, yes. I think we're looking at what we can do to give people the best impression of what was actually here originally.
Yeah. So in terms of heritage projects, as you can tell, there's many exciting opportunities to be anticipated.
Yet.
Absolutely.
Because there's more to see further on.
Absolutely. Let's go. So, Ian, here we are at the end of the Talyllyn's actual formal running line, and we find ourselves at the foot of the Athwilt incline, which was the first of a series of inclines which ran up into the quarries. What's happening here?
Right. Well, as you rightly say, Frank, this is the foot of the first of the inclines that went up to the quarry. This was the limit of the working for steam locos. Steam locos couldn't work any further than this. And, of course, this is where passengers' trains run to at the moment. But what happened next? That's something that a lot of our passengers don't know. So what we're trying to do here is give people an indication that what they're seeing here is actually the first of these series of inclines. And this display, which is being put together with the help of track siders and the outdoor week gang, is going to eventually help provide that sort of interpretation, that understanding for people, so that they know what originally happened here, that the empty wagons went up to the quarry, loaded wagons came down, and we're trying to take it back.
Again, very green.
Yeah, it is, you know, very green technology.
Totally carbon neutral.
Yeah, that's it. So, you know, we hope this will be something that will really help people understand that this was a slate railway, and I think this is really important. We are part of World Heritage Site, Northwest Wales.
That feeds in beautifully to the Talyllyn being a component of the UNESCO World Heritage Site for the North Wales Slate environment, which beautifully knits together the social history, the cultural history, the industrial history, and of course the railway itself. And as the Inquirer rightly says, the Abergynolwyn village. So it's an exciting time. We've got a lot of heritage projects in the offing. Watch this space as things develop. We'll be bringing you further videos showing you developments as and when they occur. And thank you very much for watching.